the journey of our young democracy. In ANC, we were witnesses to the defining moments of Philippine history that influenced the world.
To the service of the nation.
Chronicle the journey of a dynamic young population as it makes its mark in a robust economy.
We don't just tell stories, we tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
This is the Philippines.
The success story we want to share with the world, and we are ANC.
Good morning, I'm Christian Esguera and this is Matters of Fact. Here are today's headlines. The novel coronavirus has now killed more than 300,000 people worldwide. Philippine authorities reconsider quarantine or community quarantine classifications ahead of the implementation of the modified enhanced community quarantine in Metro Manila, Laguna, and Cebu starting tomorrow. A Philippine senator says the upper chamber can pass a bill granting a provisional operating franchise for media giant ABS-CBN before June. And parts of the Philippines under signal number 3 due to Typhoon Ambo. The global death toll from the new coronavirus has now exceeded 300,000. More than 4.4 million cases have also been recorded, while at least 1.5 million patients have recovered, according to the Johns Hopkins University. The United States still has the most number of COVID-19 cases with more than 1.4 million. The United States has also recorded 85,000 deaths and over 240,000 recoveries. The United States could face the darkest winter of recent times if it does not improve its response to the pandemic. The warning coming from a vaccine expert who claims to have been ousted from his U.S. government post for raising concerns about coronavirus preparedness. On Thursday, Rick Bright told lawmakers that America lacks a plan to produce and fairly distribute a coronavirus vaccine when it becomes available.
Our window of opportunity is closing. If we fail to improve our response now, based on science, I fear the pandemic will get worse and be prolonged. We need to be truthful with the American people. Americans deserve the truth. The truth must be based on science. We have the world's greatest scientist. Let us lead. Let us speak without fear of retribution.
U.S. President Donald Trump described Bright as a disgruntled employee.
I never met him. I don't want to meet him. But I watched him, and he looked like an angry, disgruntled employee who, frankly, according to some people, didn't do a very good job. And I think we're going to have a vaccine by the end of the year. And I think distribution will take place almost simultaneously because we've geared up the military.
Bright was removed last month as director of the Biomedical Advanced Research and Development Authority. That agency is responsible for developing drugs to fight the new coronavirus. The Japanese government lifts the state of emergency in most parts of the country, but the measure, which was imposed due to the pandemic, still applies in Japan's largest urban regions. The details in this report.
Tokyo and Osaka are to remain in a state of emergency while the rest of Japan starts to get back to normal after Prime Minister Shinzo Abe lifted the emergency in 39 of Japan's 47 prefectures on Thursday. The world's third largest economy declared the nationwide state of emergency a month ago, urging citizens to reduce person-to-person contact by 80% to slow the spread of the virus and ease pressure on medical services across the country.
While controlling the spread of the virus as much as possible by acting on the premise that the virus is all around us, we'll restore ordinary work and daily life.
The 39 prefectures in which the emergency has been lifted account for 54% of Japan's population, but the Greater Tokyo area alone accounts for a third of the economy. While Japan has avoided the kind of explosive growth seen in the United States and elsewhere, its testing rate has also been among the lowest. Abe said experts will assess the situation for the areas under restriction next week.
Experts are warning of a major mental health crisis as the coronavirus pandemic drags on. The World Health Organization is now urging governments to put the issue front and center in their response to the outbreak.
Headlines about mounting death tolls and disease, fake news and political battles, people losing their jobs, economic recessions hitting across the world, people stuck indoors, and people facing it on the front lines.
We cannot take it anymore. Amen.
It's a depressing combination, of course, and the United Nations is asking governments that as the pandemic crisis drags on, not to forget about the mental health toll that this is having on many, many people. It needs to be front and center in the response, they say. Devorah Kestel is the director of the World Health Organization unit that deals with mental health, drug, and alcohol abuse.
We have seen in the past that similar cases of economic crisis have increased the number of people with mental health issues, leading to high rates of suicide, for example, due to the mental health condition or the substance abuse, for example. Some surveys that were done in Canada, where 47% of healthcare workers reported need for psychological support. 47%, so almost half of them. In China, we have different figures for depression, 50%, anxiety, 45%, insomnia, 34%. The numbers are there, and these are just preliminary, we know.
The WHO's report released on Thursday also shows high levels of distress in the United States' general population, about 45% of those surveyed. Children and frontline workers, they say, are among the most vulnerable groups. Reuters has itself met many doctors and nurses across the world experiencing combinations of panic, grief, nightmares. The WHO did outline steps that governments can take to help ease this burden, including addressing past underfunding of psychological services and pushing online resources, such as video conferences with therapists.
Here at home, the Philippine Health Department confirms 258 new COVID-19 cases, bringing the nationwide total to 11,876. More than two-thirds, or 188 of the new patients, are in Metro Manila. Several hospitals, including the San Lazaro Hospital in Manila, are preparing for a possible surge in coronavirus cases as the country begins to ease quarantine measures.
Mga around January, ang capability lang namin, ang capacity lang namin na i-admit noon is nasa 23. We only have 23 allotted beds for COVID cases. Hanggang na-increase na namin to 248 beds. And ngayon, we are preparing for 16 more. We are preparing for the worst case scenario. Anything is possible kasi, so pwedeng talagang tumaas. I'm not saying natataas after ECQ, but there's always that possibility. I think our healthcare workers are ready. Ready with regards to that possible scenario.
18 more people died from COVID-19, raising the death toll to 790. Meanwhile, the total number of recoveries is now at 2,337 after 86 more people recovered from the illness. Philippine authorities will begin implementing the modified enhanced community quarantine in Metro Manila, Laguna Province, and Cebu starting tomorrow. As Pia Gutierrez tells us, some businesses will be allowed to resume operations, but not those that cannot afford to provide transportation for their employees.
The Philippine government announced that it will allow Filipinos to again work abroad as it moves to relax lockdown protocols to prevent the spread of COVID-19.
Naaproban din po na ang mga land-based or sea-based OFWs ay papayagan pong umalis para sa abroad. Kailangan lang po na magsumiti sila at lumagda ng deklarasyon na alam po nila ang risk na kanilang haharapin kung sila po ay pupunta sa kanilang mga trabaho.
However, Filipino healthcare workers covered by the deployment ban of the POEA will still not be allowed to leave the country.
Dahil nga po pinapayagan ng umalis ang ating mga land-based at saka sea-based OFWs, pinayagan na rin po ang mga recruitment and placement agencies na mag-operate no, sa areas ng modified enhanced community quarantine at sa general community quarantine.
Malacanang also warned companies under industries that will be allowed to partially operate that they have no business restarting their operations if they cannot provide public shuttles for their workers starting May 16. This comes as the palace defended the government's decision to continue to ban public transport under the modified enhanced community quarantine, even as they allowed several industries to resume. Workers, however, complained not many companies can provide transport services to their employees. Roque, however, says banning public transport was a policy decision to prevent a second wave of COVID-19 infections.
Unti-unti, dahan-dahan, dahil ayaw po natin mapagaya dun sa ibang mga bansa na nagbukas ang ekonomiya at nagkaroon ng second wave. So kung hindi naman po kaya talaga ng kumpanya na magbigay ng shuttle o kung walang sasakyan yung kanilang mga empleyado, wag na po munang magbukas dahil mas importante na ma-avoid po natin, maiwasan yung second wave na tinatawag. It's a policy decision po. We want to restart the economy but not at the expense of having a second wave.
In the meantime, the Interagency Task Force on Emerging Infectious Diseases is studying the appeal of several local governments to reconsider their community quarantine classifications. Roque says at least two provincial governments, Bulacan and Pampanga, are appealing to be included in areas under the MECQ for fear that relaxing quarantine protocols would lead to a rise of cases in their areas.
May tinayo po tayong validation committee para mag-receive at aktuhan po itong mga apilang ito.
Starting May 16, only Metro Manila, Cebu City, and Laguna Province will be placed under the modified ECQ, while the rest of the country will be under the general community quarantine. Nilinaw ni Roque na mananatili sa GCQ ang may 37 probinsya at 11 lungsod na una nang inilagay sa modified GCQ hanggat wala pang nilalabas na guidelines ang IATF para rito. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
Regional authorities have approved the implementation of a modified enhanced community quarantine in the province of Bulacan beginning tomorrow. But local officials are still waiting for the recommendation of the National Interagency Task Force. Bulacan Governor Daniel Fernando says they want to ensure the safety and health of their residents. Local authorities are awaiting the results of COVID-19 tests as they collect more samples among local residents. Data from the Bulacan Provincial Health Office show there are 139 COVID-19 patients in the province and 27 fatalities due to the disease.
Alam kong gustong-gusto na nilang magtrabaho. Alam kong gustong-gusto na lumabas ng lahat para makapaghanap buhay. Okay. Isusugal ba natin ang ating buhay kung kikita nga tayo? Kung ang kapalit naman ay ang pagbawi ng iyong buhay.
Governor Fernando also hopes there will be additional aid for those affected by the quarantine measures under the national government's social amelioration program. Philippine police have arrested 40-year-old construction worker Ronald Kiboyen for offering a 100 million peso bounty online to whoever could kill President Rodrigo Duterte. That's after a 25-year-old public school teacher was also apprehended for making a similar offer. What are the implications of such arrests? Let's ask Attorney Jose Manuel Diocno, who now joins us on the line. He's the chairman of the Free Legal Assistance Group, or FLAG. Good morning, Attorney Diocno, and thank you very much for joining us again this morning, sir.
Good morning, Kristen, and everyone who's watching.
Okay, so over the past several days, we've seen reports regarding arrests of certain people who posted certain comments online. Now, basically, there are two types of comments here. One was the comment made by at least three people threatening the life of President Rodrigo Duterte, supposedly. And the other was that of a salesman who called President Rodrigo Duterte, quote-unquote, crazy online. I'll start with the case of the salesman there. Was it really something criminal as regarded by the police, or was it a protected speech?
Well, you know, the concern I really have with this recent arrest, all of these arrests were done without warrant, meaning that the one who decided whether a crime was committed was the police and not a judge. While the police do have limited authority to conduct warrantless arrests, the real power to deprive a person of his liberty rests with the judge, especially when it comes to cases that involve speech like libel, especially when there's no complaint yet filed by the president or anyone who's been the subject of the speech. It's very concerning that the police will decide on their own initiative what is whether that is a crime or not. Typically, the law enforcement has authority to conduct an arrest if a crime is happening in their presence or if there's hot pursuit. But, you know, crimes like libel and other speech crimes, they don't happen in the presence of the law enforcement. So I really question their authority to effect warrantless arrest. If they believe a crime was committed, proper procedures for them to file the complaint before the prosecutor's office and let the judge be the one to decide whether they should be under arrest or not.
So they cannot...
We're talking about freedom of speech here, and of course, generally, that kind of speech is protected.
So the policemen cannot claim that a crime is occurring in their presence, even if they cannot claim that the fact that it was posted online and the comment is still there, that is a crime committed in their presence. They cannot do that.
I think that would be stretching the concept a bit too far, and that would be giving them the kind of discretion that the law never intended to give the law enforcement. When you have a crime that involves libel, for example, it's the judge has to weigh so many factors in deciding whether that kind of language really is libel. For example, when you have the president himself has uttered very scurrilous language against other individuals, disgraced people online, publicly, and so forth. And the question is, when an ordinary citizen follows suit, is that now libel for him? Then what happens to the accountability of the official who they're a model for that kind of language in the first place?
But of course, they can claim that the president is immune from suit.
That's a separate question. The president can still be sued. The only question is that the proceedings will be deferred until after he's no longer sitting in the office. But the filing of the suit is not denied. We're not deprived of that opportunity to file.
So in this case, what should have been the procedure? Let's say you have a salesman who posted something against President Duterte and his former aide and now Senator Christopher Bongo. What should have been the process there?
Well, first, for cases of crimes of libel, you need a complainant. So either Senator Bongo or the president himself would, if they feel they've been victimized, should have filed a complaint, and that would have kickstarted the entire process. Then the police could have conducted an investigation and filed, if they believe sufficient, a complaint before the prosecutor's office. If the prosecutor's office, after preliminary investigation, believes there's enough probable cause, then they file the case in court. And it's only at that point that the judge would be the one to decide whether to issue a warrant of arrest or not. And what is concerning is it's a bit of a shortcut when it's the police themselves who will make that decision and immediately deprive a person of his liberty without giving that process a chance to work.
How about in the case of those who offered, quote-unquote, a so-called bounty to anyone who could quote-unquote, kill President Rodrigo Duterte. So,
Again, you know, there's a big debate about whether that kind of speech is protected or not. And again, that would require the impartiality and the knowledge of a judge, I believe, to decide that. I recall there was one case in the United States where a demonstrator in a rally said that if I were given a gun, the first person I'd shoot would be the president. Mm-hmm. And the Supreme Court in the U.S. said that's hyperbole, that's protected speech, because there was no real intent to incite violence. You need someone knowledgeable in the law to make that decision. I don't know that it's good that we give that authority to law enforcement.
So usually you also look, you don't just look at the face value of certain comments made online, even if that could be construed as a threat. Do you also look into the capability, the background of the person who made that statement? Because anybody can make such a statement, and it can turn out that that person is just joking or, as you mentioned, using hyperbole.
Even the president has made similar statements.
Precisely, yeah.
And so I think what you have to look at is, number one, the intent. Was there really real intent to incite violence? And is the language likely to incite that kind of violence? If it was more of hyperbole, a figure of speech, then it should be protected.
If, however negative or incendiary the statement may be against the president?
Yes, because we're talking about public officials, and there's a long line of jurisprudence that says that they should be thick-skinned, they should understand that part of their position is being criticized by the public. It may even be caustic at times and even hurtful, but it's still considered as speech that is allowed.
So,
that's what I mean. I mean, I'm not making a judgment on whether that speech after it was actually criminal or not. Mm. But it should be a judge who should make that decision rather than law enforcement on the ground.
So what's the recourse for, let's say, people who have been arrested because of comments they made online? Can they go after the arresting officers? Can they go after the police or the NBI?
Well, they would have to go through the usual process first. If they were arrested without warrant, an inquest should be conducted. The inquest prosecutor should first determine if the arrest was lawful or not. If there is a determination that it was an unlawful warrantless arrest, then they can pursue whatever remedies they feel are fit. If the prosecutor, on the other hand, decides that the arrest was lawful and there's enough evidence to file the case, then the person arrested would have to pursue his remedies before the court.
So, you can go after the arresting officer for possibly illegal arrest and illegal detention.
Those are among the remedies that would be available to them, theoretically, yeah.
Because here, we're looking at the manner of arrest. For example, the public school teacher in Zambales, it was very much apologetic for the post that he had made. But the fact was, he was already arrested and he was detained. So, I mean, given the disadvantages of that situation in that ordinary public school teacher, what are the options available to you when everyone within the law enforcement agency is against you?
Yes, and I understand there are certain issues with regard to the arrest of that public school teacher, insofar as its alleged admissions that were made or given to the law enforcement apparently without any lawyer being present.
Mm.
There's also issues whether the so-called Miranda warnings were given to him before he was questioned. It's based on what I've seen online, these admissions were made upon questioning by the police without the benefit of counsel. These are things that are clearly prescribed by law.
Is your group, the Free Legal Assistance group, basically, are you also assisting some of these respondents? Or are you handling any similar cases so far?
At the moment, we haven't been officially engaged in any of these cases.
Mm-hmm. Explain to us, talk to us about the concept of the continuing crime, because in some of these arrests, we always hear this this justification coming from law enforcers that it's a continuing crime and committed perhaps even in their presence, and somehow they use that to justify the arrest of someone.
Well, the concept of continuing crime really was never connected to arrest as it was formulated by the courts. The concept of continuing crime was came about because of crimes like kidnapping to determine which court has jurisdiction. But in a crime like kidnapping, a person could be kidnapped in one place but deprived of liberty in another place. The question then before the court is which of those places can is defiled, which court has jurisdiction. So it was not intended to be a justification for arrest. That's why, as far as I'm concerned, and we in the human rights community, we really take issue with using the concept of continuing crime to justify an arrest. See, hindi naman yun yung purpose talaga ng concept na yan. And we feel that the grounds for conducting a warrantless arrest are very clear in the rules of court, and if law enforcement should really just follow what's in the law.
Okay,
when you allow a concept of a continuing crime, especially when it's for an online post, you're in effect broadening the grounds for a warrantless arrest.
Okay.
For instance, like what happened in the case of Ms. Beltran in Cebu, where her post was used to justify her warrantless arrest.
Now, let's now for the education of the public or even the law enforcers themselves, what would justify a warrantless arrest?
A crime that is happening right before the very eyes of the law enforcers, or a crime that has just been committed, and when they respond, they conduct a hot pursuit of the persons who were involved in it. Those are the kinds of offenses that are subject of a lawful warrantless arrest, or a person who is lawfully arrested and then later escapes from detention or from jail.
Okay, those are
the grounds that the law allows.
Okay, so those are three very clear grounds. Now, can that also be used, a warrantless arrest, for example, against anyone who, according to the police, is violating the quarantine measures, for example?
In my own personal view, Derek, I think that if the offense did not occur in their presence, or the hot pursuit does not apply, then the police should file the appropriate complaint before the prosecutor's office and let that process unfold, and let the judge be the one to decide whether to issue a warrant for that person.
For example, law enforcers who are trying to implement, let's say, rules on physical distancing, let's say they see people roaming around close to each other, wearing no face mask. Can that justify an arrest, for example?
If there is an ordinance in that area prohibiting it, making it a crime, and providing a penalty, and it's happening in the presence of the police officers, they can. That would be a lawful warrantless arrest.
Yeah, because I'm asking these nitty-gritty questions because people, especially online, are trying to compare how the government is implementing the law against those who are criticizing the government vis-a-vis those who are actually part of the government. For example, you know for a fact that there's this big controversy regarding the head of the National Capital Region Police Office who held a party. They don't want to call it a party, but if you look at the pictures, for all intents and purposes, that looked like a party. So people are also asking, can you also, using that same argument by law enforcers that they use against ordinary people, can they also use that against those who actually held a party in the middle of a lockdown?
Yeah, the law of justice is supposed to be blind. It should not distinguish between those who are part of the administration and those who aren't. If anyone violates the law, regardless of their political persuasion, the law should apply to them. That's why we say that no one should be above the law. And that's really a concern that we've had for some time, that the law in our country is used to favor very often those in power.
Okay, Attorney Chel Diokno, thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Oh, you're welcome. Please, at any time. Good morning.
Now, the CEO of pharmaceutical giant Sanofi says the COVID-19 vaccine should reach all regions. Paul Hudson's statement comes after he received backlash for saying that any vaccine developed by Sanofi in the United States could go to American patients first. He says he's deeply sorry for that comment, which sparked debate. Sanofi is working on two vaccine projects against COVID-19, including one with British rival GlaxoSmithKline. Up next, we'll talk to Mayor Timoteo Villar of Pangasinan, who's getting flack for flouting quarantine rules by holding a birthday party. Stay tuned, you're watching Matters of Fact.
I choose to be fresh.
Dandruff-free fresh. That's why I switched to all new Clear.
In the first ever liquid fresh formula, it instantly removes dandruff for all-out freshness and zero dandruff.
Does your shampoo keep you fresh?
Christian Izguera, Karen Davila, and Kathy Yang. Arm you with the most relevant facts. Give you a breakdown of the most pressing issues. And deliver the stories behind the numbers. As you start your day every day, only here on ANC.
Going for groceries? Need health and beauty products? Running to the pharmacy? What about finding all your must-haves in one place? Welcome to Mary Mart, your household essential store. No need to waste time going from one place to another. Everything you need is right here. Nothing can be merrier. Mary Mart, your household essential store.
Para sa lahat ng ating pinagdaanan, para sa lahat ng pinapangarap pa sa buhay, ipaglaban natin ang ating tahanan. Ito ang ating ABS-CBN. Ilagay natin ang ating kamay sa puso, tanda ng pagmamahal sa isa't isa bilang isang pamilya. Ang nagbuklod sa atin ay mga balita para sa ating pag-ahon sa buhay. Sabay tayong umiyak at tumawa sa mga programang nagbibigay ng inspirasyon, pag-asa at saya. Nagtulungan tayo sa iba't ibang serbisyo publiko. Sinubok na at napatunayan ng panahon. Tayo ay kapamilya forever. Lalaban tayo together. I-post ang larawan ng inyong pakikiisa sa inyong social media accounts gamit ang hashtag LabanKapamilya. Gawing public ang inyong post para makita ito sa LabanKapamilya wall o ipadala ito sa labankapamilya@abs-cbn.com. Ipaglaban natin ang serbisyo sa Pilipino. Ipaglaban natin ang ating ABS-CBN.
After the quarantine in Luzon halted the operations of public transport, the community joined hands. Bike Scouts Philippines help frontline workers get to work.
We are a community-based project. We started in 2013. We provide, of course, bicycles and support for bicycles for people who need mobility, specifically frontliners.
Angkas begins its food delivery service, providing food options and income for their bikers.
This is really more of a temporary service, just so that our bikers can continue to have some work and also, you know, provide much needed goods to the communities.
Many contractual workers in the Philippines risk losing their jobs. Fortunately, some of them were able to find a new source of income thanks to an app called My Kuya.
On our application, we match our customers with the services that they need for grocery services, purchase of supplies, running errands and messengerial needs due to the enhanced community quarantine.
Yeah. Lahat ng ating pinagdaraanan, malalampasan natin basta't may pagmamahal. Sa pagtawid ng ating pag-ibig sa ating mga kababayan, nairaraos nila ang pagkain ng kanilang pamilya. Salamat sa pagtugon nyo. Kasama ang mga mabubuting kumpanya at organisasyon, patuloy tayong nakapagbibigay ng tulong sa ating mga kapamilya. Tunay kayong maaasahan sa oras ng pangangailangan. Patuloy ang ating pagtanggap ng donasyon para sa ating mga kababayan sa pamamagitan ng ABS-CBN Foundation. Kapamilya, matatawid natin ang lahat ng ito nang dahil sa pag-ibig.
Magandang gabi, bayan!
Stay updated with the daily issues and current events.
Tulad po ng aming pinangako, nagbabalik ang ating TV Patrol
with the Philippines' leading local evening newscast. The national stories presented to you by the country's trusted anchors and reporters.
Nakikitaan na ng magandang epekto ang enhanced community quarantine sa kaso ng COVID-19 sa Pilipinas.
Ngayon pong huling araw ng distribusyon ng unang tranche ng Social Amelioration Program.
TV Patrol. Watch it nightly here on ANC, the ABS-CBN News Channel.
Sa mga akala nila hindi seryoso itong nangyayaring COVID-19 sa buong mundo, is very serious. This will either kill you or this is actually a wake-up call for all of us. My line of work, kailangan makipaghalubilo ka. Hindi mo alam kung saan manggagaling yun. Wala pa tayong vaccine for this. Sundan po natin lahat ng mga sinasabi sa atin ng mga authorities.
Pahalagahan ang bawat buhay. Manatili po tayo sa loob ng bahay. Isang paalala. Mula sa ABS-CBN.
How best to deal with the threat of the coronavirus disease or COVID-19? Frequent proper hand washing is advised. Cover your mouth and nose when coughing and sneezing. Avoid close contact with the sick. Wear protective clothing around farm and wild animals.
Cook food thoroughly. Avoid consuming undercooked animal products.
Keep a healthy lifestyle to boost your immune system. Arm yourself with information. A friendly reminder from ANC.
Welcome back to Matters of Fact. Here's a recap of the stories you need to know this morning. The novel coronavirus claims the lives of more than 300,000 people worldwide. Philippine authorities reconsider community quarantine classifications ahead of the implementation of the modified enhanced community quarantine in Metro Manila, Laguna, and Cebu tomorrow. The Philippine Senate can't pass a bill granting a provincial franchise for media giant ABS-CBN before June. That's according to Public Services Committee Vice Chairman Senator Sherwin Gatchalian. And parts of the Philippines under signal number 3 due to Typhoon Ambon. The Philippines now conducting more than 9,000 COVID-19 tests per day. In a briefing on Thursday, Carlito Galvez, the chief implementer of the National Task Force on COVID-19, reported an average of 9,200 daily tests following a 70% increase in laboratory capacity. Galvez also said 166,470 individuals have been tested, while the distribution of rapid test kits has reached 177,500.
Sa pagtaas ng testing capacity ay dahil sa pagdami ng ating accredited COVID-19 laboratories. Sa ngayon, mayroon na po tayong 30 testing centers sa buong bansa na nagsimula ng noon lamang na 3 lamang. Inaasahan po natin na mas lalawak pa po ang ating kapasidad sa pagtetest kapag natapos na ang accreditation ng mayroong 58,000 laboratories sa buong bansa.
The government has stressed the importance of mass testing as restrictions are eased and local governments prepare for the new normal. The Philippine Health Department finalizing policies for sectors that will resume operations under the modified enhanced community quarantine. Health Undersecretary Rosario Vergere says the policy will cover the screening process to determine who are fit to work. It will also include protocols and minimum health standards that should be implemented. Under the modified ECQ, the Interagency Task Force has identified industries that can reopen with as much as half of their workforce. The Civil Service Commission also encourages employers to adopt alternative work arrangements to minimize the danger of the novel coronavirus spreading in their workplace. In other news, Typhoon Ambo continues to weaken after making another landfall over Burias Island. The storm earlier made landfall in eastern Samar, northern Samar, and Masbate. The eye of the storm was last spotted in the vicinity of Claveria town in the southern tip of Burias. It's packing winds of 125 kilometers per hour and gusts of up to 165 kilometers per hour. Several areas in the Bicol region and the Quezon province are under signal number 3. Metro Manila, Pampanga, and Bulacan are among the areas under signal number 2, while signal number 1 is up over the northern portion of Luzon as well as parts of the Visayas. Moving northwest at 15 kilometers per hour, Ambo is forecast to battle toward the Ragay Gulf before making landfall over the Bundok Peninsula in southern Quezon later this morning. Batangas City is bracing for the possible onslaught of Typhoon Ambo. After being battered by heavy rains on Thursday, residents started to rescue their roofs and their boats. The incident management team of Batangas City will also begin evacuating coastal residents today. The buses that will be used for the evacuation, as well as shelters and relief goods, have all been readied. But local officials admit that evacuating residents amid the spread of the new coronavirus will be a challenge.
Hindi sila evacuate na walang mask. Kung mayroong walang mask, aming bibigyan ng mask. Tapos ay yung physical distancing. Ang aming plan ay ang pag-re-evacuate ay per family para hindi magkahalo-halo. Pag talagang madaming-madami, pwede natin lagyan ng separators. Tsaka talagang imamanage na maigi ang isang room.
May COVID pa nga pong hinaharap ngayon. Kailangan pa rin ho na mag-ingat tayong lahat po, lalo na ho kami din eh. Wala naman po kami pambili eh, para kami mag-prepare.
The Philippine House of Representatives will vote next week on ABS-CBN's provincial franchise. At least one lawmaker says that authority is merely a breather as the local chamber scrutinizes spending bills and the network's franchise renewal. RG Cruz reports.
Copies of House Bill 6732, as approved on second reading by the Philippine House of Representatives Wednesday, are being circulated among congressmen. Final voting on this bill is expected to happen next week. Since it is not certified urgent by the president, at least 3 days must pass before it can be voted on final approval to give congressmen time to review the measure. After it gets the final nod of the House, it will be transmitted to the Senate, and should the Senate approve it, it will need to be signed by the president. The president's signature is still the quickest way to bring ABS-CBN back on air because the franchise would be effective immediately upon publication.
Ang pinakamabilis yan, as any bill for that matter, I'm not just referring to ABS-CBN, ano? Any enrolled bill that lands on the desk on the desk of the president, nagiging ano kaagad yan, immediately kung pipirmahan.
Inaasahan ko naman po na kung wala naman pong constitutional infirmity, pipirmahan naman po ito ng presidente dahil pinarating na niya ang mensahe sa mga miyembro ng Kongreso, he is neutral, do your constitutional function. It's not only the best move, it's the only move under our constitution.
The network supporters thanked the House for the lifeline it gave the company.
Kung ano munang kayang ibigay sa ngayon ay isang bagay na ipinagpapasalamat ko na.
As always, the ABS-CBN will be independent and will be not biased and will present the facts as they report them. And so to me, this is not a short leash or anything. This is at this time, this is the best that we can get because our objective here is to be able to restore as soon as possible the ABS-CBN operations.
But Deputy Speaker Neptali Gonzalez reminds the network this is just a breather to afford Congress the time to scrutinize all pending bills seeking the renewal of the network's franchise. Gonzalez also calls for hearings to be scheduled soon, and these should cover not just the franchise application but even allegations of franchise violations.
Hindi pa pwedeng tumaas ka agad ang ating mga ano na, ay, at the end of the day, ano na tayo? We ABS-CBN has reached a point na talagang, yun ang talagang kailangan humarap talaga sa Kongreso.
And should a new franchise be granted, lawmakers are seeking to introduce reforms that will apply not just to ABS-CBN but all broadcasters in the country.
Kaya natatagalan because of the so-called allegation of violation of the franchise, variation of law, or mga political, ano, alam mo na these are the things that that ABS-CBN should address and address in the committee. Hindi pwede address to outside of the committee. By all means, I think I'm positive that ABS-CBN will have a chance. Hindi mo pwede sabihin sa ABS-CBN, sige, bigyan namin kayo ng franchise, pero during election, hindi na kayo pwede tumanggap ng political ad. Hindi na kayo pwede mag-commentary sa mga political position. Then, that will, on number one, that's a prior restraint, no, sa Constitution.
In the meantime, the National Telecommunications Commission has responded to the show cause order issued by the House Committee on Legislative Franchises. The regulator says it was bound to shut down ABS-CBN. The NTC argues it did not issue a provisional authority because it respects and recognizes the sole prerogative of Congress to issue legislative franchises to broadcast companies. The NTC adds it also considered the warning of the Solicitor General that its members could face criminal charges if it issued a provisional authority. Led by Commissioner Gamaliel Cordoba, the officials apologize for the confusion their order has caused, especially as the country faces the COVID-19 pandemic. The House committee will study the NTC's response before deciding if they should be held in contempt. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Over at the upper chamber, Philippine senators are grateful that the House of Representatives finally acted on ABS-CBN's franchise renewal. But they believe lawmakers should grant the network a longer provisional franchise than just 5 months. More from Sherry Ann Torres.
Members of the Senate on Wednesday immediately took note of the House of Representatives' swift second reading passage of House Bill 6732, which grants ABS-CBN Corporation a 5-month provisional franchise which will run until October 31, 2020. At the session, Senator Grace Poe formalized her inhibition from the network's franchise hearing due to conflict of interest. Poe's mother, actress Susan Roses, is connected with ABS-CBN. The network is also home to the movies of her late father, Fernando Poe Jr.
Senator Sherwin Gachalian, the vice chairman of the Senate Public Services Committee, will be the one who will lead in handling the two franchise bills pending in the Senate, aside from the one which will be turned over to them by the lower house.
Gachalian is confident they would only need two hearings to finish the bill, since the Senate Public Services Oversight Committee already scrutinized the network's records and capacity last February 24th. Gachalian is open to the possibility of passing the ABS-CBN franchise bill before the end of the month.
There is an urgency to hear the franchise because kung makaka-operate ka agad ng ABS at makakatulong sa paglaban sa COVID, better.
Senator Manny Pacquiao, who is supportive of granting another 25-year franchise to the network, thanked the lower house for finally acting on the ABS-CBN franchise bill.
Salamat po, nagiging fair po tayo kasi kahit doon sa ibang mga company, binigyan din ng provisional authority. Tapos itong ABS-CBN, hindi mabigyan natin. So parang magiging bias ang pananaw natin, ang resulta natin, ang tingin sa atin nito ng tao. So ito, maganda yung ginawa natin.
Over at Teleradyo, Senate President Vicente Soto III affirms the Senate can immediately pass the ABS-CBN franchise bill, provided that they will not see any problem. Still, Soto frowns on the 5-month franchise period the lower house is giving to ABS-CBN.
Ang hindi ko maintindihan, gusto kong tanungin, bakit yung franchise na ina-approve ng House, 5 months. Mayroon lang ako nakarinig ng 5 months na franchise. 25 years, bakit 5 months?
Soto was referring to Senate Bill 981 that seeks a 25-year franchise for ABS-CBN and Senate Bill 1521 eyeing a provisional franchise for the network until June 30, 2022. Senate President Pro Tempore Ralph Recto, principal author of SB 981, maintains he prefers a 25-year franchise for the network. Recto is hopeful that they will still be able to pull the network's franchise to 25 years. Senate Majority Leader Juan Miguel Zubiri plans to talk to their House counterparts to appeal for a longer provisional franchise period for the network. Since hearing it again before October, he says, will only exacerbate the lawmakers' already tight schedule addressing COVID-19 and typhoon impacts. The Senate Minority Bloc supports the idea of extending the provisional franchise period.
If we give them provisional franchise, then let us give a 1 year. Ako, no less than 1 year ang aking position dyan.
Kami sa minority, sigurado ko ay kikilos sa loob ng parameters na meron ngayon ang Senado. And we will certainly try to push the envelope na bukod sa mas mahaba ng time frame na nakapaloob sa Senate bill kumpara sa House franchise bill.
We expect this to be on the floor by the last week of May, and be with the president first week of June. Now, whether or not the president will sign it, or will sign it immediately, or the end of the month.
The Senate will still send a copy of its adopted resolution, appealing to the National Telecommunications Commission to reconsider its issued cease and desist order to ABS-CBN Corporation. Sharian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
Sports news now. The top honcho of the NBA G League says he's not surprised by the buzz surrounding Filipino star Kai Soto. G League President Sharif Abdurrahim told Philippine sports media that Soto is on his way to hopefully becoming the first Philippine-born player to be drafted into the NBA. On Thursday, Soto confirmed that he was signed by the G League select team. He joins other top prospects who would have been big-time recruits in the National Collegiate Athletic Association or NCAA Division I. The International Olympic Committee expects to pay up to $800 million for the delayed Tokyo 2020 Olympics. IOC President Thomas Bach on Thursday said the committee would set aside $650 million toward the organization of the Games that will push through next year. The remaining $150 million will be allocated to support international federations and national Olympic committees.
To enable them to continue their sport, to continue their activities, and to continue their support to their athletes.
International federations rely on Olympic Games contributions every year. Other major sources of revenue have dried up in recent months due to a ban on sports competitions worldwide. Six-time Formula One world champion Lewis Hamilton is the richest sports person in the United Kingdom. The UK-based newspaper The Sunday Times reported that the 35-year-old has a net worth of £224 million. That's equivalent to $275.6 million. The F1 driver saw his net worth rise by £37 million over the last year after he signed a contract with Mercedes in 2018. Hamilton overtakes David Beckham, whose shared net worth with his wife, fashion maven Victoria, was $200 million by the time he retired from football in 2013. The global fashion and luxury industry bracing for tough times ahead, even after the COVID-19 pandemic ends. A survey by the American-based Boston Consulting Group found that more than 20% of respondents from the United States, UK, Italy, and France plan to spend less on outerwear and luxury purchases and more in savings, healthcare, and organic food. A study by the Philippine National Economic and Development Authority reflects this same attitude, with 70% of Filipinos unwilling to spend on travel or durable goods in the next year, even after the enhanced community quarantine. The fashion industry overall is poised to lose around $450 billion to $650 billion US dollars in sales this year. Filipino national artist Bencab expresses his support for ABS-CBN and the renewal of its franchise. Ben Cabrera shared his thoughts on the cease and desist order against ABS-CBN's free channels through his Facebook page. He said that journalists and artists could give their best only in an atmosphere of freedom. He added that freedom enables the nation to confront poverty, treason, and rising tyranny that make the ongoing pandemic much worse than it already is. He called on artists to remember that they should be free to express themselves without fear. A drive-through cinema in Dubai now offering people an escape from home confinement. Vox Cinemas has turned the top floor of the Mall of Emirates into an outdoor cinema where passengers in up to 75 cars could watch movies on the big screen. Cinema goers can tune into a radio channel to listen to the movie. Because of social distancing rules, only two people are allowed inside each vehicle. Australian soap opera Neighbours is filming again, but as this report tells us, there will be no kissing, hugging, or fighting in the new episodes as part of strict physical distancing measures. Take a look.
It's Dr. Kennedy.
Hi, Carl. It's Steph.
It's been a staple of Australian TV and shown around the world for more than three decades. Now soap opera Neighbours is back and filming new episodes, but don't expect any more kisses, hugs, or punch-ups. The show's had a month-long break while producers rewrote scripts to ensure the actors could stick to social distancing guidelines. Executive producer Jason Herbison.
This is an unprecedented situation. There's no rule book for it. So what we really had to do was just stop, listen to the government advice, look at the way we film the show, and in consultation with our cast and crew, really formulate a plan where we felt we could all return to work safely.
The number of characters in scenes has been reduced. Actors and crew have temperature checks when they arrive on set, and where possible, the talent will do their own makeup. And a colour coding scheme helps ensure that if someone develops symptoms, it will be easier to trace people they've been in contact with.
Whereas in the past, characters might have kissed, you know, now we might have them lean in for a kiss and then the camera pans away and we hear a little bit of a giggle, but we don't actually see the moment.
Right, well, I'm a family friend, so.
But viewers catching up on their daily dose of soap will not hear any direct references to what we've all been experiencing lately. It's been decided not to make mention of it in the scripts. Producers say a show called Neighbours simply wouldn't work if characters were isolated.
We have this just in. Former Senator Tesi Aquino Oreta has passed away at the age of 75. Malabon Mayor Len Oreta announced on Facebook that his mother passed away late Thursday night. We'll have more details in our later newscasts. And that will do it for the show. I'm Christian Esguera. You can catch the weekly ANC Matters of Fact podcast on Apple, Spotify, Google, and Stitcher. You can also watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online by subscribing to the ANC YouTube channel. Now connect with us on Twitter at ANC Alerts or email us at ancfeedback@abs-cbn.com. Catch us again same time on Monday here on Matters of Fact. Stay home and stay safe.
In a time